Yeah. Thank you. Naram Chaiva Narottamam
Naram Chaiva Narottamam
Devim Sarasatim Vyasam
Devim Sarasatim Vyasam
Tato Jayam Mudiraye
Tato Jayam Mudiraye
Nastaprayeshu Papakrishu
Nastaprayeshu Avadrishu
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhagavate Uttama Shloke Bhakti Bhavati Naishtiki.
Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter 2, Text Number 36. Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari sarvatma sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Tasmat sarvatra sarvada. Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Shrotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari
sarvatra sarvada.
Yaksha
Srotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam. Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Srotavya kirtitavyascha. Srotavya kirtitavyascha.
Srotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Tasmat sarvatmana rajan.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Hari sarvatra sarvada.
Srotavya kirtitavyascha.
Srotavya kirtitavyascha.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Smartavyo Bhagavan Nirnam.
Tasmat.
Tasmat.
Therefore.
Therefore.
Sarvam.
Sarvam.
All.
Atmana.
Atmana.
Soul.
Soul.
Rajan.
Rajan.
O King.
O King.
Hari.
Hari.
The Lord.
The Lord.
Sarvatra.
Sarvatra.
Everywhere.
Everywhere.
Sarvada.
Sarvada.
Always.
Always.
Shrotavya.
Shrotavya.
Must be heard.
Must be heard.
Kirtitavya.
Kirtitavya.
Glorify.
Glorify.
Cha.
Also.
Also.
Smartavya.
Smartavya.
Be remembered.
Be remembered.
Bhagavan.
Bhagavan.
Personality of Godhead.
The personality of Godhead.
Nirnam.
Nirnam.
By the human being.
By the human being.
Translation. Okay. It is therefore essential that every human being hear about, glorify, and remember the Supreme Lord, the Personality of Godhead. always and everywhere. Prabhupada, my Srila Prabhupada. Srila Sanatana Goswami begins this verse with the word Tatsvam. Oh, Sri Sukadeva Goswami begins this verse with the word Tasmat, or therefore, because in the previous verse he has already explained that there is no auspiciousness, there's no auspicious means for salvation other than the sublime process of Bhakti Yoga. The Bhakti Yoga process is practiced by the devotees in different methods like hearing, chanting, remembering, serving the lotus feet of the Lord, worshipping, praying, rendering service in love, becoming friendly, and offering all that one may possess. All nine methods are bona fide methods, and either all of them, some of them, or even one of them can bring about the desired result from the sincere devotee. But out of all the nine different methods, the first one, namely hearing, is the most important function in the process of Bhakti Yoga. Without hearing sufficiently and properly, no one can make any progress by any of the methods of practice. And for hearing only, all the Vedic literatures are there, compiled by authorized persons like Vyasadeva, who is the powerful incarnation of Godhead. And since it has been ascertained that the Lord is the super soul of everything, he should therefore be heard and glorified everywhere and always. That is the special duty of the human being. When the human being gives up the process of hearing about the all-pervading personality of Godhead, he becomes victim to hearing rubbish transmitted by man-made machines. Machinery is not bad, because through the machine one can take advantage of hearing about the Lord. But because machinery is used for ulterior purposes, it is creating rapid degradation in the standard of human civilization. It is said here that it is incumbent upon the human beings to hear, because the scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam are made for that purpose. Living beings other than human beings have no ability to hear such Vedic literature. If human society gives itself to the process of hearing the Vedic literature, it will not become a victim to the impious sounds vibrating by impious men who degrade the standards of the total society. Hearing is solidified by the process of chanting. One who has perfectly heard from the perfect source becomes convinced about the all-pervading personality of Godhead, and thus becomes enthusiastic in glorifying the Lord. All the great devotees like Ramanuja, Madhva, Chaitanya, Sarasati Thakur, or even in other countries, Mohammed, Christ, and others have all extensively glorified the Lord by chanting always and in every place. Because the Lord is all-pervading, it is essential to glorify Him always and everywhere. In the process of glorifying the Lord, there should be no restriction of time and space. This is called Sanatana Dharma or Bhagavata Dharma. Sanatana means eternal, always and everywhere. Bhagavan means pertaining to Bhagavan, the Lord. The Lord is the master of all time and all space. And therefore, the Lord's holy name must be heard, glorified, and remembered everywhere in the world. That will bring about the desired peace and prosperity so eagerly awaited by the people of the world. The word cha includes all the remaining processes or methods of bhakti yoga, as mentioned above. Om Mahyanatandarandasya Yananjanashalakaya Chatsurumilitandhyena Asmai Shri Gurave Namaha Vanchakaupatarubhyashya Kripasindubhayevacha Pakitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Translation again. O King, it is therefore essential that every human being should hear about, glorify, and remember the Supreme Lord, the personality of Godhead, always and everywhere. So this is a very important statement here, coming from Sukadeva Goswami, and he's describing the need for everyone to engage in bhakti yoga. So particularly mentions about the processes to hearing, glorifying, and remembering the Supreme Lord. Hearing, glorifying is chanting and remembering. So the first three stages of the Bhakti Yoga process, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, right? The first three, Bhakti Yoga is progressive like that. There are nine different angas by which we can perform Bhakti Yoga. But the first three are more important. And the others, they come gradually. Particularly at the end, the last two, which is becoming the friend and surrendering everything, they're especially elevated processes of bhakti yoga. So without being on the platform of raga bhakti, without being coming to the spontaneous level, then one is not encouraged to attempt to become the friend of Krishna or to surrender everything. But we're encouraged to engage more in the first three processes, particularly hearing, which is the first thing. Lord Chaitanya gave great importance to the hearing process. There was a discussion between Ramananda Rai and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Ramananda Rai was a very learned person, very great devotee. And Lord Chaitanya, he was a sannyasi and from a Brahmana family. Ramananda Rai was actually from the Sudra family, but he was a very learned person. He was not a sannyasi also, he was a householder, but he was very well educated in the scriptures. So Lord Chaitanya asked him, tell me a verse from the scripture about the bowl of life. So Ramananda Rai began by talking about, he gave a verse which talks about the importance of following Varnashram. Varnashramacharapakumumshenaparapumam. There's a verse in the Padmapura which says that just simply by following the duties of Varnashram Dharma, you give pleasure to the Lord. But Lord Chaitanya said, they said, no, that's external. That's just some, you may do, just like, you know, you do something, but it doesn't mean you do it with feeling or with any real devotion or mood. So Lord Chaitanya said, just following Varnashram, that is just, it's not, it's all right, but it's not the goal of life. It's not the highest principle of religion. So then Ramananda Rai gave another verse, and this time he gave a verse from the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, all that you do, all that you eat, all that you offer and give away, as well as all austerities which you may perform, should be done as an offering unto me. So this is called karma arpana, offering the results of your work to Krishna, to God. So Lord Chaitanya said, well, that's not really enough, because all that you do, you may offer things, but you may offer them to many people. You may offer karma arpana, offering the results of your work. People may give the results of their work to different, get demigods. But Lord Chaitanya wants to hear about devotion, bhakti, and devotion means to Krishna, to the Supreme Lord Krishna. And if you just simply do karma arpana, just offer the results of your work, you know, you can give to so many temples, and who are you going to offer to? So Lord Chaitanya was not very satisfied. He said, you have to go further. So then Ramananda Rai gave the verse from the Bhagavad Gita, which comes in the 18th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, give up all your dharmas, give up all your duties, and just surrender to me. Sarva dharma parityajna mamekam shadam. Now that's generally considered to be the conclusion of the Bhagavad Gita. To give up, to surrender fully to Krishna, give up all your dharmas and just take shelter of Krishna. But Lord Chaitanya said, no, he said, that's also not enough. Because, you know, people may have different motives why they surrender to Krishna. Sometimes people just want to get away from their responsibilities and from their duties. There was one man came to Prabhupada. This was in Hong Kong, actually. There was one man there. He was a Sindhi, actually. He's a Sindhi. So he came to Prabhupada and he said, Swamiji, I want to take sannyas. So Prabhupada looked at him and said, oh, why? He said, I have a wife and four kids at home. It's terrible. So, of course, Prabhupada did not give him sannyas. That's not a reason to take sannyas. That is trying to go away from responsibility. But taking sannyas is to accept more responsibility. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he took sannyas when he was 24 years old, and he left his mother, elderly mother, and his young wife also. But he took the sannyas for a greater responsibility. Not to give up the responsibility, but to take greater responsibility. And just simply giving up duties, sometimes people come to Krishna consciousness, they just want a place to eat and sleep. They think, I didn't come here to work, I just came to eat. They just want to chant and eat, you know, and they don't want to do anything. So that's not good either. So different motivations are there behind surrendering to Krishna. So the motivation should be simply for the pleasure of Krishna. You see, it must be to please Krishna. So Lord Chi kind of rejected that again. So then Ramananda Rai then gave another verse, also from the Bhagavad Gita. Sarva-dharma kariyasmi, that is swadharma-tyag, giving up all duties. But then the next verse Ramananda Rai gave, also from Bhagavad Gita, from 18th chapter, where Krishna says, Brahma-bhuta prasannatma na sochati na kanchati samasarveshu bhuteshu madbhaktim labhate param. Now this verse is describing not pure bhakti, but bhakti mixed with jnana, jnana-nishra bhakti. So jnana-nishra bhakti, because he's talking about seeing all living entities equally and realizing your Brahma Buddha prasannatma, you should know your Brahman, and then you become a joyful soul. So there's no emphasis on devotion. So Lord Chaitanya didn't like that again, because it's more impersonal. Jnana, knowledge. Knowledge is often leads to impersonalism. If you just simply cultivate jnana, it often leads to impersonal, mayavadi philosophy. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says also, you cultivate knowledge, bahunam jnanam ante jnana vamman prapati. Takes many births and death. After many births, one who is actually in knowledge, when a person actually comes to knowledge, then they will surrender to Krishna. Vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sadurvamha. So the goal of knowledge is to surrender to Krishna. But a lot of people, they may take to the path of jnana and they may not come to that conclusion. Then they simply become attracted to the Brahman and to the impersonalism. They think that is the goal, to become one with the Brahman. So Lord Chaitanya said, no, and then next verse was acceptable by Lord Chaitanya. The next verse was from Srimad Bhagavatam, from the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, where Lord Brahma was offering prayer to Krishna. And Lord Brahma was praying to Krishna that one should remain in whatever position one is in. You know, sometimes people think that they have to change their ashram, give up something, you know, they have to move. They think they have to change. But Lord Chaitanya liked this verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, because you don't have to change your position. That's not important. Whatever ashram, whatever position you're in, just stay in that position. Stay in that position. But while you're in that position, you should hear about Krishna. You need to hear about Krishna. That is important. So hearing about Krishna, that is very important. And you have to hear in the association of devotees. So that, when Lord Chaitanya heard that verse, then Lord Chaitanya said, oh yes, this is very nice. To hear about Krishna, stay in whatever position you're in, and hear about Krishna in the association of devotees. And the result of that is that you will conquer Krishna. Although Krishna is ajita, is unconquerable, it becomes conquered by the person who hears about, simply by hearing about Krishna, becomes conquered. Krishna becomes conquered by that mood of the devotee who becomes absorbed in hearing about him. And we see that the same point is mentioned also in the Bhagavad Gita. Now, Bhagavad Gita is 18 chapters, so the first 6 chapters is the progression of yoga. We see the yoga ladder described. And at the end of the 6th chapter, Lord Krishna describes it that the top of the yoga ladder is bhakti, that the other yogas are preliminary to bhakti. Karma yoga, and then above that, jnana yoga, and above jnana yoga, then dhyana yoga, and then above bhakti. So this is the yoga ladder. Karma kanda is not even on the yoga ladder. Karma kanda is material activity. But karma yoga is a yoga. But karma yoga is working, but they don't know why they're working. They just offer the results. They don't know anything. So above karma yoga is jnana yoga. They start to know, they start to learn. And then above that is dhyana yoga, where they start to actually meditate and concentrate on what they've learned. You see, dhyana yoga, the meditation. And the goal of that meditation is then to take up bhakti yoga, where you engage in service, where you actually take up the activities, the hearing and the chanting. So Krishna said at the end of this 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, yoginam api sarvesham madgate antaratmanam. Of all yogis, the topmost yogi is the one who is always absorbed in being engaged in my transcendental loving service. So the next chapter, chapter 7, is the beginning of the middle portion. Chapters 7 to 12 are describing bhakti yoga. And Krishna begins in the 7th chapter, the first verse of the 7th chapter, he describes that, Krishna said, now hear from me, O Arjuna. Because he said bhakti yoga is in the beginning, the topmost, so how to, then the next verse begins, now hear. Hearing is the beginning of bhakti yoga. You have to hear first. And then when we hear nicely, then we repeat. And when we are hearing and repeating, then the remembrance comes naturally. So this is the idea that Krishna says in the 7th chapter, the first verse, hear from me, Arjuna. How? By practicing yoga in full consciousness of me, you can know me in full, free from doubt. So just by hearing, the doubts could be removed. So we give great importance to this hearing process. And we see Maharaj Parikshit, he is preparing for death, because this whole Bhagavatam is, you know, his preparation for death. He has 7 days to live. And then after 7 days, he's going to be bitten by the snake bird. So Maharaj Parikshit is spending his time hearing. How is he preparing for death? He's preparing for it by hearing. Simply hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. So sometimes we joke, you know, there's this one society, they call themselves the art of living. So wonder what is it? This Bhagavatam is the art of dying. Spend your time just simply hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. And the result of hearing then Srimad Bhagavatam, antakalecha mamiva smaranupa kalevaram. If you can, the result is at the end of life you can think of the Lord. And if the consciousness is on the Lord at the end of life, then we will go to be with the Lord. We'll get successful life. You can go to the spiritual world. So everything comes about by hearing. We have to hear. But it's important to hear from the devotees. Sometimes, just like chanting of the holy name, chanting of the holy names is there, and we may think, oh, they're chanting the holy name, but somebody may be chanting the holy name, it may be that they're Mayavadi or impersonalist. So their chanting is compared to milk touched by the lips of the serpent. If the snake touches the milk, then it will put a poisonous effect into the milk. Now usually we think of milk as something very delicious, but when you put when the snake touches the milk, then it becomes poisonous. So the same way, the holy name and the glories of the Lord, just like Srimad Bhagavatam and so on, these things, when we hear from the wrong people, then it can have poisonous because they will give, they're thinking it's not devotion. They're thinking, or not, even if it's devotion, they're thinking devotion is the means to impersonalism, to liberation, to their becoming one, to their merging with the Lord. So in this way it becomes harmful to hear. So we're very cautious about who we go to hear from and where we hear from. We want to hear through the parampara. Hearing from the parampara is important. And of course, even the impersonalists, they also have parampara. You have to be careful. Shankaracharya also has parampara. You know, you can see there's a parampara there. You know, they have their parampara, Adi Shankara, and then his disciples, and you have a whole line of the gurus, you know, the parampara. But it is all Mayavada, impersonalism, monism, Advaitavada. So it's be very, very dangerous to hear from them, because it can bewilder the mind. So therefore it happened on one occasion that Advaita Acharya was preaching Yoga Vashishta. There's one book called Yoga Vashishta, and this Yoga Vashishta talks about impersonalism. It's all impersonal philosophy and the glories of Brahman. So this one devotee, he was a devotee, Advaita, but he began to preach from the Yoga Vashishta. So when Lord Chaitanya heard about that, then Lord Chaitanya went there and beat him. He threw him on the ground and beat him. And he said, "You're a rascal." He said, because Advaita had brought Lord Chaitanya here, he called Lord Chaitanya to come. So when Lord Chaitanya said, "You brought me here and now you're speaking this Yoga Vashishta. You're speaking all this Mayavada nonsense." So we're very careful about who we hear from, what we hear. It's not that all scriptures are good. Some scriptures are preaching more about the impersonal world. We have to be very conscious. Okay, any question? Queen Rukmini, Vidarbha, without becoming a man, without being absolutely Vidarbha, without Vishis Vidarbha. So Rukmini, she never met Krishna, but she heard about him first from Narada Muni. And she just heard about Krishna. She understood that I want Krishna for my husband. You know, and she looked to Krishna and she told Krishna. And so Rukmini became Krishna. She just heard about Krishna. And there's another well-known story about the Brahmana. He went to a sangha, and he heard in the sangha, he heard that even you don't have paraphernalia to worship Krishna, you can worship Krishna in your mind. And you may not have any deity or any paraphernalia or any, but you can do everything in your mind and you can get the same benefit. So this Brahmana, he heard this and he thought, he was very poor, he didn't have any paraphernalia himself. So he thought, I will do my puja in the mind. So every morning he began to do manasa puja. And in his mind he had a beautiful deity, and he would go to the holy river, the different holy rivers, he'd go in and collect water, and he'd bring the water from the holy rivers, and he'd bathe the deity with the water from the holy rivers. And then he would dress the deities mentally, within his, he'd do all the puja mentally, dressing the deity and putting on nice flower decoration and flower garlands. And then he would cook for the deities also. He had nothing, so he would do everything in his mind. And he was cooking a feast for the deities in his mind. And one day, he was doing this for a long time, one day he was cooking sweet rice. So, you know, sweet rice, when you cook kheer, it shouldn't be hot. It should be cool, you know. And so he was cooking the kheer, but he didn't know if it was cool enough to offer yet. So in his mind, he put his finger in to see if it was hot. And he burned his finger. So he was surprised. That, you know, how is it I got my fingers burned? Because he was only doing this mentally. It was only manasa puja. But he still burned his finger. And so he wondered what had happened. And at that time, Lord Krishna in Goloka, he was watching and he was laughing. And when he was laughing, then his consort said to him, "What are you laughing about?" And he told this Brahmana. So he said, "Let me bring him back." He brought the Brahmana back to God. So the Brahmana went back to the spiritual world to be with Krishna. He didn't do anything physically, he did everything mentally. But and it was all accepted by Krishna. So just like some people, they do manasa puja, you know, they have their shallow ground. They have to do manasa puja. It's not the best way, but sometimes you don't have any choice. But how did he come to do that? He heard about it. He heard that he could do this. So he did it. He started to do it. So that's the value of hearing. You know, people hear in the third Krishna consciousness movement, we make our propaganda by speaking about Krishna, by going and chanting in the public places. We go for Sankirtan. Let people hear the holy name. Let people hear the Hare Krishna mantra. Sometimes people become devotees. They just see the devotees chanting and they become attracted. They just hear the holy name. So hearing is very important. And in Srila Prabhupada's time, there was one musical. It was a musical theatrical performance which was taking place in London. in London and Broadway, or you know, like Broadway in New York. So they had some theater performance. It was called Hair, and in this Hair show, they would sing Hare Krishna, they would sing the Maha Mantra, and they did some kind of dance and they chanted Hare Krishna. And Prabhupada heard about it. He said, "Oh, this is very good." He said, "They have taken the Maha Mantra from us." He said, "Because we brought the Maha Mantra to the West, so they've taken it from us." So he said, "That would be good chanting." So they heard from devotees, but not everybody hears from the devotees. Some people hear from the Mayavadis, and they get a different idea. And they think the goal is to become one, the goal is to be to merge, and Krishna comes from the Brahman. They don't understand. You get so many, there's so many wrong things. People have so many misunderstandings. They think Krishna died. Krishna got shot by an arrow and he died. They don't understand who is Krishna. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Abhajananti mam mudha manushim tanamash param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta mahishma. The foolish mock at me descending amongst them like an ordinary person. They do not know my transcendental nature and supreme dominion over all that be. So ordinary people with no education, they think Krishna is an ordinary person. And they think Krishna took birth like we took birth. And they think Krishna died like we're going to die. But Krishna doesn't take birth and he doesn't die. He appears. He comes in this world. He appears in this world. Sri Jamyaham, I manifest, Krishna manifests himself. Prabhupada gives an example, just like the sun rises in the morning, it's not a new sun. It's just that the sun was hidden from us in the night, and in the morning the sun rises. So in the same way, Krishna appears. He's hidden from our vision, but then he appears. And similarly, he doesn't die, but just like the sun sets, so Krishna also disappears. The sun sets, the sun is no longer visible to us. So Krishna also disappears from our vision. But he doesn't die, he doesn't take birth, he is the supreme spiritual being. So ordinary people, they don't know, they can't understand these things. They don't understand who they are. So how will they understand Krishna? If we are thinking I'm the body, we're thinking I'm body, they think Krishna is also body. They don't understand. We're not the body. We are souls living in the body. So, once we understand that, then we can understand Krishna. That Krishna is the supreme spiritual being. And we have to purify our consciousness by hearing about Krishna and Krishna's teaching. So that's why we read Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. We have to hear more and more. Sarvatra sarvada, everywhere, always. So Lord Chaitanya told the Brahmana from Kurukshetra, there's a place in India, Kurukshetra, it's a Sri Sampradaya temple, the Ramanuja temple, Kurukshetra. Ramanuja had gone to Jagannath Puri and he was telling that your puja is not right. He was complaining to the king of Puri that you're not worshipping Jagannath properly. You're not doing the puja properly. And he wanted to change everything. So Ramanuja Acharya, he's a big guy, very powerful, very famous. When he had thousands of disciples. So he'd gone to Puri and he was talking to the king of Puri and telling him that this puja worship is not right. You have to do it, change. It's not according to Shastra. So the king thought, he's a big acharya, I better do what he said. So he called a meeting. All the brahmanas had to come the next day. They were all told to come tomorrow morning. You have to come having a meeting. Ramanuja Acharya is here, he's going to address you. So the next morning, they all came. Only person who was not there was Ramanuja Acharya. What had happened to Ramanuja Acharya? During the night, when Ramanuja Acharya was taking rest, Lord Jagannath took him out of Jagannath Puri. He took him out and put him in Kurukshetra. Lord Jagannath didn't want him interfering in the puja. So he took him out from this. So Ramanuja Acharya could not change the puja. Lord Jagannath was happy with the worship. He didn't want any changes. So let him continue. So Ramanuja woke up, he found himself, what's this way? He thought it was a Shiva temple. He saw the deity, he thought it was a Shiva. Then he found out it's not Shiva, it's Kurma. So this is Kurmakshetra. So Ramanuja made a temple there, Kurmakshetra. So it's on the south. When you go from Jagannath Puri to Vishakhapatna, there's a town there, place there, village there, Kurmakshetra. So Lord Chaitanya was there. He met the Brahmana. He told the Brahmana. Because this Brahmana, what happened was this Brahmana was a grihastha and in a family. And he brought Lord Chaitanya to his home and he fed him and honored him and everything. But then when Lord Chaitanya was going to go, the Brahmana said, take me with you. He said, I want to go with you. He said, I cannot tolerate any more the pains of the material world. This material life is terrible. Please take me with you. And Lord Chaitanya chastised him and said, this is wrong. He said, wherever you go, whoever you meet, tell them about Krishna. In this way you become good spiritual. But you don't make advancement just by changing, just by going away and giving up the responsibility. But stay in your position. Stay in your position and tell people about Krishna. This is Lord Chaitanya's deed. And this is confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam. Jnane prayasamuda pasya namanta eva jivanti san mukaitam bhavadiya vartam stane stita shruti gatam tanvan manobir ye prayaso jita jito. Stanestita, stay in that position and hear about Krishna. Jita jitopi asita shilokyam. Jita, Krishna is ajita, but he becomes jita, he becomes conquered. He's unconquerable, he's ajita, but he becomes conquered by the devotion, by the devotee. Who hear about it. Okay? Hare Krishna.
Prabhu, can I ask one question?
Okay.
About the Ekadasi.
Oh.
So normally in the month we have 2 times Ekadasi. But Prabhu is doing everyday Ekadasi.
I don't restrict Ekadasi. No, I think something said it all. Usually on Ekadasi we don't take dal and beans and grains. So I'm not doing strict Ekadasi, I'm just not taking
Wow.
So basically, many people say that you eat meat, then you get the vitamins from the body, kind of thing. You are meat eater, means that those are meat eaters, they will say that you are vegetarian, you have less vitamins like B12 kind of thing. So how the we get those vitamins as vegetarian? Something like doctor always recommends that you have a lack of vitamins because you are vegetarian.
Well,
but I see you are more healthy than others.
Then you don't worry so much about doctors. You doctors, their business is to get you to take medicines. They will always try to push you, their thing. Everybody does that. But the doctor says, there is a business. Oh, you need this medicine, you need that. I don't have a lot of faith in the doctors. And Prabhupada also told us like that. He said that, don't give me to the doctor. He was his own doctor. Took some Ayurvedic medicine. So again, be careful who you hear from. Everyone's got their own motivation.